this is where it's come down to, where the current TNA champion is literally a cosplay of the Ultimate Warrior. So we have the Elite copying the NWO, we have Kevin Owens copying Stone Cold Steve Austin, and we have Moose literally dressing up like the Ultimate Warrior, and they call him the Ultimate Moose, right? Wrestling is now openly presenting itself as a cheap bootleg of what came before, right? But that's for another video. That's for another video. Here, we're reviewing Money in the Bank, so let's get started. Now, the first match of Money in the Bank was the four-way tag team title match. Now, Kofi Kingston was a mid-card tag team guy. He was the third guy on the New Day. But last year, for some reason, it was Kofi Mania. For no apparent reason, fanboys were treating him like he's the next big thing, like the next Shawn Michaels. So he wins the title, gets destroyed by Brock Lesnar, and now he's back to being a nobody. Now he's back to being a mid-card tag team guy in the opening of match of this card, like nothing happened, right? This just goes to show that the WWE doesn't make stars anymore. They have temporary main eventers. Last year was Kofi Kingston, this year is Rudy Poo-Joo, and neither of them are real stars like The Rock. And matches like these are why I don't routinely record pay-per-views. It's because today's product's like all the same. All these four-way matches are the same. I mean, you have a spot, break up the pin. Have a spot, break up the pin. Have a spot, break up the pin. It's like all the same. There's no real story. I actually prefer one-on-one matches where it's like the Macho Man versus Ric Flair. And it's like these two charismatic personalities and they're clashing in the ring. But these four-way matches, just random people taking turns diving outside the ring. Like, what is there to review? It's like all the same. The Forgotten Sons look like forgotten members of Aces and Eights. And they had that third guy, Jackson Ryker, who was outside the ring cheating for the team. The referee catches him and says, "Get out of here!" And Jackson Ryker's like, "Oh, man!" And then he leaves. It's like, what the hell? This is a no DQ match. Why do you have to leave just because the referee told you to leave? You look like a stupid idiot. It's like the referee's like, "Get out of here!" And Jackson Ryker's like, "Okay." It's like, what the hell? So then after R-Truth comes out and sings to no audience, he was actually coming out looking left and right. Look, there's people there. After that garbage, we had Bayley versus Tamina. Right, now this was actually a pretty decent match. You could tell both wrestlers were working very hard. But the problem is that there's no reason to get into it. I mean, again, Macho Man versus Ric Flair, there's reason to get into it. Bayley versus Tamina, there's no reason to get into it. And the finish of the match made Tamina look like a total idiot. She Samoan drops Bayley, she has the pin, but instead of getting the pin, she chases Sasha Banks around the ring, and then she gets pinned. I'm like, it's like, what a fool. If you do that, you don't deserve to be champion. So far in this pay-per-view, Jackson Ryker and Tamina look like total idiots. Now, the next match was the title match between Braun Strowman and Bray Wyatt. Now, the obvious question is, why was this a regular match? Even though Bray Wyatt was trying to get Braun Strowman to rejoin him, why didn't he do that warping around thing that he effectively did with John Cena? I mean, I talked about this a few videos ago. Continuity, right? If The Undertaker can fly, why doesn't he fly during the match? If Matt Hardy can warp around the arena, why doesn't he warp around during the match? And if Bray Wyatt can change the environment and has all these superpowers, why doesn't he do it during the match? And what about those stupid puppets, those dolls? I mean, they didn't even do anything. I mean, why would you put a doll in the middle of your show just to insult people's intelligence? What the hell are you doing here? What do you mean, what am I doing here? I am the future of TNA. And just how long have you been the future of TNA? About as long as Seth Rollins has been the future of WWE. Well, that's true. So anyhow, there's no denying that I'm the next TNA Heavyweight Champion.
Dude, you're like a foot tall.
So you admit it. You admit that I'm the absolute smallest wrestler ever.
Yeah, and you have no muscles.
So you admit it. You admit that I'm a scrawny little jobber, which makes me the best TNA Heavyweight Champion.
I think your logic is kind of broken.
No more broken than the fanboys.
Well, that I agree with. But come on, man. Even Tessa Blanchard is bigger than you.
So you would get out of here! So the next match was Rudy Poo-Joo versus Seth Rollins. And this is why ratings will stay in the toilet. I mean, do you know how this looks to mainstream audiences? To mainstream audiences, it looks like two guys who look about the same, doing moves on each other, and there's no reason to cheer for either of them. It almost feels like the WWE is intentionally making wrestlers look the same. There's nothing to distinguish these guys. To the mainstream audience, they look the same. It's just two guys who look the same, trading moves in the ring. To the mainstream audience, it's just not interesting. Even the NXT champion just looks like a different version of Rudy Poudreau. They all look like different versions of the same guy, and there's no reason for any casual fan to get behind any of them. Dude, it's just different variations of the same thing. Look, you're not gonna keep an audience when you're just doing the exact same thing over and over again and just changing it slightly. Who the hell are you?
Oh, you know? Me and the future of AEW.
You're the future of AEW? You look like a tiny little guy in a sweatshirt.
So you admit it! You admit that me boring! You admit that me a next world champion!
I think your logic's kind of messed up.
Me the same as your fanboys!
Well, that I agree with.
Me! Elite! Me! Elite! Me! Elite! Me! Elite!
You're being repetitive!
So you admit it!
Next was the Money in the Bank ladder match, and overall, it was an entertaining match. I liked the idea of wrestlers racing their way to the top of the building, and you have all these cameos along the way. I liked the idea, but the execution was off, right? Number one, there was no sense of urgency. This is supposed to be a race where wrestlers like racing their way to the top. But the wrestlers, they were like stopping for casual conversations, food fights, there was no sense of urgency. AJ Styles, who's behind everyone else, he's like casually walking in the hallway looking for Rey Mysterio. There was no sense of urgency. And as an audience member, it destroys the tension and the feel of the match. It's supposed to be like 100 miles an hour. I like the idea of people making cameos during the match, but the execution was off. The cameo should happen while maintaining that sense of urgency. The wrestler should not be walking casually, taking their time, stopping, and then the cameo happens. No! It should be a rush to the top. For example, Rey Mysterio is walking casually, he stops, and then Brother Loves comes out of the bathroom. Why would Rey Mysterio stop for that? He is in the middle of a match. He should be rushing to the top. He's trying to win a race here, right? Why would he stop for someone coming out of the bathroom? What should have happened was two wrestlers should be fighting. They're fighting their way to the top. One of them kicks open the bathroom door, and Brother Love is on the toilet like. And then he closes the door, and the wrestlers keep fighting, and they don't even know what happened, because they're trying to make their way to the top. That's what should happen. That's how the cameo should happen, during the rush to the top. Number two, the logistics made no sense. How did the other wrestlers catch up to Asuka so fast? She should have been way, way ahead. The other wrestlers, they were like wasting their time doing the food fight in the meeting room. Asuka should have been like five floors ahead. But inexplicably, the other wrestlers just kept catching up to her for no reason. It was almost like Mario Kart 64 rubber band gameplay, where no matter how far ahead you are, they just keep catching up. AJ Styles was stuck under the weights, so he's like way behind everyone else. But for some reason, he's casually walking in the hallways in no rush whatsoever. Then he has an on-screen flashback of The Undertaker. Then Alistair traps him in a room, even though Alistair is supposed to be way ahead. You see what I mean? The positioning of the wrestlers in the building makes no sense. Alistair is supposed to be ahead, but for some reason he's behind. It's Mario Kart 64 rubber band gameplay. Everybody is tied together with a rubber band. Nobody ever really falls behind. The match would have been better without the rubber band gameplay. There should have been a wrestler that got stuck on the first floor and he never made it to the top. Throughout the match, there should have been wrestlers getting stuck on various floors and they never made it to the top. There should have been a map in the corner of the screen, like a video game, showing the positioning of each wrestlers, which floors they're on, which ones are getting stuck, and which ones are catching up. That would have made more sense, but not every wrestler should have made it to the top. Mario Kart 64 rubber band gameplay is a form of 50-50 booking, and we don't want that. So as I recall, Asuka was the first one to make to the roof, which makes sense even though she should have been way ahead. But then Baron Corbin comes in, and he tries to stop Asuka from getting the briefcase, which makes no sense. I mean, they're not in competition, so why not just get it together? Fanboys online are making excuses like, oh, it's because Corbin has an ego, but that's stupid. He should know that if he pushes Asuka, Asuka's gonna push back, which makes him look like an idiot. And how the hell was Otis the second guy on the roof? That makes no sense. He was food fighting? He was wandering casually in the cafeteria? How the hell was he the second guy on the roof? Again, there should have been a map in the corner of the screen explaining the positioning of the wrestlers. So Asuka gets the women's money in the bank briefcase, which I agree with. But then Otis accidentally catches the men's money in the bank briefcase, and the fanboy fantasies continue. Look, nobody is going to get into this Otis Mandy Rose shit except for the fanboys and the nerds who are living through him, right? This is like Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels fighting over the briefcase. Bastion Booger accidentally catches it, and the fanboys are like, yeah! You know, look, wrestling is getting the least viewership of all time right now. You think this shit's going to bring him back? In my opinion, the fanboys are continuing to destroy wrestling until there's nothing left. I was looking at the message boards, and it seems like the most ridiculous parts of Money in the Bank, like the flashback and the food fight, that's the stuff that the fanboys like the most. I mean, look, there seems to be a major disconnect between what the fanboys want and what the mainstream fans want. Why the hell do you have a neckbeard taped to your face?
Me, the future of AEW! Me need to relate to the fanboys!
You fanboys! Me just like you! Me just like Kevin Owens! Me just like you! Me just like Otis! Me just like you! You like them! So you like me too! Yeah!